The federal government will review a controversial CRTC decision on usage-based internet billing. Industry Minister Tony Clement said the government would decide by March 1st whether to accept, review, or reject the decision, which allows internet service providers the right to charge higher prices to people using more bandwidth. Is that a solution to network congestion or anti-competitive and unfriendly to consumers? Mirko Bibic is the Senior Vice President of Regulatory and Government Affairs for Bell. Great to have you with us.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
Now, as one of the providers, which will now be allowed to charge different rates for different bandwidths, let's start with why, if your fixed costs are behind you, you own the network, why do you need to charge more for somebody downloading a smaller amount versus somebody, a larger amount versus somebody downloading less?
Well, Amanda, I think it's certainly there's been a whirlwind of activity around this decision in the last few days or hours, but it's really, really important to put the issue into proper context first. Last week's CRTC decision will affect maybe 30,000 of the absolutely heaviest internet users who, going forward, would be charged in exactly the same way as millions of other internet users have been charged for years now. So usage-based billing is actually not new at all. We've had it in place for our own customers for over 4 years. And what's changing is that that will now be extended to end users of or customers of internet service providers who ride on the Bell network. And the pricing principle is really quite simple. Those who use absolutely the most bandwidth and who cause congestion issues get charged more, and that's a fairly simple proposition in our view.
Listen, I love this policy because I'm a shareholder. That's all I care about. If you could suck every last cent out of users, I'm happy for you. But my question is, why do you need the CRTC at all to set these prices? As long as we have two providers, why can't the market be the determinant of how much you charge and how much you get and what the price should be?
Well, certainly we agree that, Kevin, that the internet market is hyper-competitive. Actually, we're fighting tooth and nail every single day with our competitors to get the business of our subscribers. So it is a competitive market, and our retail pricing hasn't been regulated in the internet space, frankly, for years. And that's why we've had the flexibility on the retail side to implement the appropriate pricing packages to our subscribers. So we've had usage-based billing in place since 2006, but the CRTC continues to regulate how we provide network access to our competitors, those ISPs who don't invest in their own networks but ride on our networks. And what the CRTC decided last week, they realized, look, if Bell is doing this to manage congestion and to price appropriately to its retail customers, it's only fair that those same pricing principles be extended to the end users of wholesale, of ISPs who use our network.
Now, the problem, of course, for big telecom in this country is that most of us feel as though we're charged too much for a lot of things, including our mobile phone service. So what the consumer's natural inclination might be to wonder whether you couldn't, even if we agree that pricing based on usage makes sense because it'll keep people from just overusing and causing congestion, maybe you could lower the prices a little bit, that there might be a little bit of room to come down. What do you say to people who have those concerns?
Well, again, context is everything, Amanda. If you just take a look at Bell's retail internet pricing packages, we have a series of options available to our subscribers that provide various speed tiers and various amounts of bandwidth under particular data caps for different prices. Fairly intuitive kind of pricing approach. And why I said context is everything is about 10% or less of our customers actually trigger their data caps and are charged usage-based billing. It's that small. And the reason it's that small is we have designed these packages to be sensitive to our customers, our subscribers. So we've designed the packages, even our lowest tier package provides more bandwidth, much more bandwidth than the average internet user. And if you happen to trigger the data cap and end up paying more, there are tools in place where you can monitor your usage online, and you can also buy extra bandwidth for very reasonable prices. For example, you can buy an extra 40 gigabytes of data for $5. So we've got very attractive pricing. We have a series of packages. We have insurance plans that allow you to buy more bandwidth for reasonable prices, and we have monitoring tools in place.
All right. We appreciate you joining us for this context, Mirko. Great to have you with us.
Thank you very much.
Mirko Bibic, Senior VP Regulatory Affairs at Bell. Well, joining us now is one of those small internet service providers facing the prospect of having to pass along higher fees to subscribers. George Berger is the spokesman for TechSavvy, an Ontario-based ISP, which offers service across Canada. Thanks for being here.
Thanks very much, Amanda. Great to be here.
Now, as a service which didn't have to invest in your own network, you do ride on somebody else's network. Why shouldn't you abide by the same kind of rate rules that Bell charges its own customers? Why should you give your customers a break?
Well, I think, first of all, that's a really false premise, because if you would have used that premise in, for example, the long-distance battles of 15 years ago, there would not be any competition in the long-distance space, because all of long-distance providers back then rode on the infrastructure that Bell had. The reason they were allowed to do that was because it was a priority for the government, for policymakers, to introduce competition so that consumers could get the best price. So I think that the premise that simply because they built it, they should control it, they should control the pricing, is erroneous. The second part of it is that, in fact, we do make substantial investments. And, in fact, if we were entitled to be able to build a more robust business, you could be sure that we'd be the first people who would be investing very heavily to do whatever improvements we could on the system.
What would be the downside of taking it all out, all this CRTC regulation and all these covenants about letting parasites ride on your system, given that many groups now, including foreigners, are building out infrastructure on their own? What do we need these antiquated policies for? How does that help me as a shareholder? How does that attract more capital for you? I don't see any upside here.
Well, to be candid, I really don't have a lot of sympathy for you as a shareholder, because obviously that's an entirely different interest. I think the reality is what's better for the public. And I should point out that Canada is virtually unique in the world in terms of how it's treating broadband usage. We are certainly the most expensive, and that's even before the introduction of usage-based billing. If you did away with all the CRTC regulations, then, frankly, you would be left with the duopoly. You called it two competitors, but it's really a duopoly of the cable companies and the telecoms. And I don't think that anybody would want to necessarily be at their mercy when it comes to pricing. Especially,
if you don't understand why you need me as a shareholder, you wouldn't have a business. I put capital at risk. If you don't give me a return, you get zero. That's how it works.
That's true, but you're not my shareholder. And if these rules stay in place, you're never going to be my shareholder. I think that companies like us have to have the opportunity to build up a business so that you could have something to invest in, so that you could see that there's a tremendous private equity opportunity in a business like ours. They're cropping up all over the world, except in Canada.
George, I think the comparison to the long distance wars is an interesting one, because people will remember that, and, you know, the whole older generation scarred by how expensive long distance used to be. Is there not an argument to be made in charging people who use more bandwidth more money, if only because otherwise the resource will become overused? People will then cause congestion when they don't need to.
Well, I'm really grateful for that question, because the reality is that bandwidth costs virtually nothing. The incremental cost of a gigabyte is somewhere in the neighborhood of about 1 to 3 cents. So there can't be any sympathy for that. You know, the CRTC made this decision on the money for nothing song. Well, I think they carried it over into this one as well, because this way Bell is making money for nothing. The incremental cost of gigabytes are marginal. Similarly, with telecom, with long distance, if you remember, at that time it was about $1.50 to make a phone call for a minute between Toronto and Montreal. Competition was introduced, it drove down to pennies, and guess what? They're still making a heck of a profit. So it's not a limited resource. It's just there. It's light.
All right.
Isn't it true in the long run that business models legislated by government are doomed to fail? Isn't that your situation? You wouldn't exist if the CRTC wasn't supporting this parasitic mandate you have.
But does that necessarily mean that it would be better for the Canadian consumer? Because at the end of
it's
not true, because then prices would be driven by whatever the duopoly chooses to set it at, which is exactly what they're doing now. You're going to pay $2 for every incremental gigabyte that costs 1 or 2 cents for them to deliver. How do you feel about that as an internet user, Kevin?
It's not a duopoly. You know, there's tons and billions of dollars of new capital coming in, even from foreigners now, building out wireless networks that will replace any landline bandwidth. There's
and it wouldn't have happened if the CRTC would have had its way. You would not have had $4 billions coming from foreigners. It took the Minister of Industry to implement that.
Are you optimistic that the government will overturn this? You must be in contact with them.
I'm sorry.
Are you optimistic that the government will overturn this, that the government will back your case and say, no, you don't have to pass on the higher rates?
I think we at TechSavvy are very gratified by the approach that Minister Clement has taken with this issue, and we're looking forward to a very just result.
All right, George, we'll be watching. Thanks.
Thank you.
George Berger, TechSavvy Solutions.